today. I'm going to teach his brother William today. His class had church service together. So his class, so and the service was at 10 o'clock. Because at first he said, well, I can teach Sunday school and just leave and go. And then he found out the service was at 10 o'clock. So he didn't have time to do that. So he says, okay, you get to do it this time. But we have a really good lesson today. And I just thank God, you know, for the opportunity, you know, to be here and to teach it and to just, you know, receive His word. And so we just want to open up with prayer first. We thank you, Father, for this day that you have made. We thank you, hallelujah, that your word giveth life and it giveth understanding to the simple. I thank you, Lord, how your word teaches us how to be victorious in this life. And we thank you, hallelujah, that I'll be able to teach this with clarity and that we'll receive what you have for us in this lesson today. Our lesson is going to come from Ruth, the fourth chapter. And we've been studying Ruth the last 2 or 3 weeks and all. And it actually skipped a chapter in this, because I believe last week we were back in Ruth, the second chapter. So it's really important that we understand what happened in the third chapter before we go on. So if somebody, let's see how much of it we need to read here to get the gist of where we are. So when we left off last week, Ruth had gone to glean in the field of Boaz, and she had found favor there. And when she had taken back all that she had gotten. Not only had she gotten blessed, you know, by being there in that place, and you know, her reputation of faith and the kindness that she had done toward her mother-in-law, God had truly blessed her, and Boaz had put a blessing upon her. And when she went back to her mother-in-law, she had so much stuff that the mother-in-law was amazed at, wow, how much stuff this is. Not only did she have more barley than you normally would have been able to gather in that period of time, but she also was able to take care of the provisions to where when Boaz had blessed her and invited her into his home to eat, that she had so much left over that she took back to Ruth. And so Ruth was astonished at what went on there. And in chapter 3, Ruth is telling her that Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And what she is referring to there is in the Jewish law that a woman finds rest or peace in the home of her husband. And we know earlier that she had told her daughter-in-law, you know, you stay here in the land of the Moabites, in your land with your people, and maybe you'll find husbands and you'll find rest there. So Naomi is concerned about her daughter-in-law. She knows she's not going to be around forever. And not only that, but she's an old lady. She can't take care of her. So she really loves her daughter-in-law, and she's appreciative of the love that her daughter-in-law had shown toward her. And it was her desire, just like any mother's desire, she loved him like a daughter, that her daughters find rest or peace or safety, because under the wings of the husband or in the husband's home, the woman finds safety. So she said, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kinsmen, whose maidens thou was, behold, he winneth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Now, in the Jewish law, the next of kinsmen had the responsibility and also the right of redeeming the property of any kinsman that had either lost it by having to sell it, you know, because he got in a financial band and he had to sell it, or even in the case of death, that all of the property that God had promised the Jews would stay in the hands of the Jews. And especially in this case, because these sons of Ruth had married women that were not Jewish women. So the property could, you know, have gone over, you know, if they intermingled with each other, the property could have gone back into the land of the people that God had taken it from to give it to his people anyway. And so it was their right and their responsibility to redeem that. So Ruth knew the law, and as a matter of fact, well, Naomi knew the law, but as a matter of fact, Ruth knew the law even better, and we established in one of the earlier lessons when Donnell asked, did he think that Ruth was walking in faith? And when she did this, and when her mother-in-law told her, hey, I know you don't have much future here in this land here. You stay here with your people, people who know you, people who will take care of you. But her husband had taught her the law, and she loved her mother-in-law, and she knew that she would be provided for. And Ruth, at that point, we had established that she may not have been totally walking in faith right then. You know, she's saying, well, it might not be so good for you in the land. I don't have anything to give you when I go back. The land had been sold when they left there, so she really didn't have anything to go back to. Actually, she did have, because she had forgotten the Jewish law there, but she was not walking in faith at that time. So she gives this plan for her daughter-in-law. Would somebody just go ahead and read from verse 4 or 3 what she told her to do?
Wash thyself therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man, until he shall have done eating and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie, and thou shalt go in, and uncover his feet, and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, all that thou saidst unto me, I will do.
Now her mother-in-law is telling her how she should behave here in this situation there. We are here in this land. The land has been sold. We have nothing, but I want things to be well with you. So this is how you're going to go about. This is how you're going to conduct yourself. This is how you're going to present yourself unto Boaz, our near kinsman. And you do these things, and her daughter-in-law was listening, and she did everything her mother-in-law said. And so she did go in, and she did exactly as her mother-in-law said. And when Boaz woke up and he saw this woman in his, at the foot of his bed, he was kind of surprised there that he was there. Someone started at verse 8.
And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid, and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thine handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman.
And a near kinsman, again, is referring to the fact that he has the ability to redeem you, or to make things well with you, or to give you rest there. Now, there was and we went on and we did this. So at the end, Boaz, in the end of chapter 3, Boaz tells her, he said, sit still, my daughter, until thou know the matter will fall. For the man will be not at rest until he had finished his thing this day. And what he was referring to there is that he had told her, look, you know, you're right, I am a kinsman, but there's somebody else in line before me that has the right to redeem you. But I think everything is going to be okay. You just wait here and let me put the matter before him and all. I think I can, you know, things are going to be right, but no matter what, you're going to be taken care of. And that's where we're going to come up in our lesson today. And verse 4. 1, when Boaz went up to the gate, and the gate was where, in the Jewish law, all the elders and important people gathered and sat around at the gate there. So he went up to the gate there, and he sat down there, and behold, the kinsman that he had talked about, or he told Ruth about, came, and Boaz spake, ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here. And he turned aside and he sat down. And he took the men of the elders of the city and said, sit ye down here. And they sat down too. So he had gone into this guy who has the right to redeem Ruth here and to get the land, redeem the land that had been sold, you know, there to have it for himself. And it was an honor for that guy to actually get the land, and it added to his wealth as well. And so he didn't want to do anything out of order. So he called all that this guy to tell him and let him know. And he says, and he said unto the kinsman, Naomi has come again out of the country of Moab, selleth the parcel of land which our brother was our brother's Elimelech. And I thought to advertise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. In other words, she's got this land to sell. It's your right to buy it. And you buy it in the presence of everybody to make it, this is a legal transaction. We don't want, there's nothing funny about it. This is yours, this is your right. I want you to understand that. I want to advertise this to you because I don't want it to be said that I went out of order and stole this land from you. This wasn't my, I understand that you are the elder here. You're the elder kinsman, and it's your right. If you want it, it's yours. Praise God. He said, but if thou will not redeem it, then tell me that I may know. For there is none to redeem it beside thee, and I am after thee. And the guy said, I will redeem it. Now, Boaz is a smart man. He says, okay, well, maybe, okay, he'll redeem it. She's going to be taken care of, and it is his right to redeem it. He said, well, wait a minute. Let me tell you the rest of what you're getting into. And there's the kinsman, he was smart too. Because he listened to the whole matter, because he could have just said, give it to me, I'm gone, I'm out of here, this is it. He said to Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the land of Naomi, thou must also buy of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the dead upon his inheritance. Now, I believe we studied back a couple of weeks ago. I think Danielle gave us a scripture in Deuteronomy 25. But we established, you know, that it was in the Jewish law, we're talking Deuteronomy, we're talking about the law here, that it was the responsibility of this kinsman, not only to redeem the property, to keep it in the Jewish hand, but it was also the responsibility of this kinsman to take the wife of the deceased and have a son. And that first son that was born as the wife was to be the heir of whatever that kinsman that had died was to have there. So now you're not only getting the land, but you're also going to have to take this Moabite woman here when you do that. He was explaining that to him. Somebody read verse 6 for us out of our lesson.
And the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it.
Okay. Now, this kinsman was kind of in an awkward situation here because of this law that I talked about in Deuteronomy. It's Deuteronomy 25 and verse 5, I believe we're going to start out. It says, if brethren dwell together and one of them die, and it's been established that both of Naomi's sons had died, and have no child, the wife of the dead shall not marry without unto a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go unto her and take her to him to wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother unto her. And it shall be that the firstborn which beareth shall succeed the name of his brother which is dead, and his name must not be put out of Israel. So Elimelech's name had to be still in the tribe of Israel, had to be remembered there. And of course, through his sons, he did have sons, but those sons are gone. So now it's the responsibility of the nearest kinsman to take on this responsibility. And if the man like not to take his brother's wife, then let his brother's wife go to the gate and unto the elders and say, my husband's brother refuses to raise up unto his brother a name in Israel. He will not perform the duty of my husband's brother. Then the elders of the city shall call him and speak to him, and if he stands to it, so they're gonna try to talk some sense into him, say, look, this is your responsibility. This is what you gotta do. He said, but if he stands to it, if he keeps to his decision, and I'm not gonna marry this woman, and say, I like not to take her, then shall his brother's wife come unto him in the presence of the elders, and loose his shoe from his foot, and spit in his face, and shall answer and say, so shall it be done unto the man that will not build up his father's house. So in other words, he was going to be a cursed man if he hadn't done that. But Boaz was a wise man, and he understood that. And so he gave him a way out up in the future where he said, okay, now, I know it's your right to do it, but I tell you what, if you don't want to do it, it's okay. I'll do it. I'm going to take over here in this case. And so now we've got the doors open for Boaz to marry Ruth. And we all know that Ruth, you know, the significance of this is that even though she was a Moabitess woman, because she was operating in faith and she had married into the Jewish law and had become as a Jew, had adhered to all God's laws, had believed the law, and the provisions made in the law for herself, so she was walking in faith, that now she gets to be part of the lineage of Jesus. Even though she was born a heathen, I think we established last time, she was got the blessing of God's children. And that's the same with us. We weren't born as Jews. We were adopted into the family, and if we accept that adoption, and we take on what God has said, live his word, live in faith, then we get the right to inherit among the Jews. I just thank God that it's just grace, all grace. She never had no right as a Moabitess woman to inherit all these things. She never had the right to be part of the lineage of Jesus. Royalty is coming through me. Praise God. Good things is coming through me. God is blessing a nation through me. Praise God. And that's what happens with us too. When we walk in faith, God can bless our neighborhoods and our schools and all of our surroundings, our world, everything that is around us. Blessings can come through us because we've become part of that lineage. We have been engrafted in. Praise God. Now this is the manner, this is verse 7, in former time in Israel concerning redeeming and concerning changing to confirm all things, a man plucked off his shoe and gave it to his neighbor, and this was a testimony unto Israel. So in other words, if this is custom, this is making sure that we, everybody under here, stand here, the deal is sealed. You have agreed that you don't want to take me. Then as next kinsman, it's my right to do this. And so this is proven that this is the transaction. We both agree. We can take off the shoe and I'm going to give it to you. That has some scriptural background. I believe Moses, did God tell him, wherever your feet, the ground that your feet touch, that shall be yours? He took off the shoe. He's right here. This land. This land is mine.
That was Jewish law.
That was Jewish law.
Yes, that's good. One of the things when I was going through the lesson and just thinking when Moab gathered those 10 men there together as witnesses, and the shoe that sort of culminated in, you know, that's equivalent to now our having, that was a Jewish law, but ours now having a written law. But when I was reading through it, I thought, what if those 10 men, because there was witness that, you know, he was assuring himself that, hey, look, everybody here, see, I've done this properly. But what if all those 10 men, this is just my man, what if all those 10 men died and then somebody later come by and said, okay, this didn't happen. But that was the law then, and they honored that. It was just like in the olden days, it was a gentleman's handshake. We shake hands on this, we agree to this, and that's how they did it. But now you enter into a formal law, you sign the papers, you have stuff notarized and all of that. But it's just kind of ushered in a different era.
Not only that, but that's teaching us that every important transaction in our lives should be done in the presence of witnesses.
Witness, absolutely.
In the presence of witnesses. You know, you hear people saying, I don't want to have no witness.
You gotta have notarized.
Run off, get notarized. Let's just run off, get married.
No, because when things are convenient, sometimes people develop amnesia about things. So
right. It's
got to be witness back.
And not only with having witnesses there, is it is showing that I'm doing things decent and in order. I don't want any talk. You know, you said we're supposed to avoid the very appearance of evil. So I don't want any talk that I didn't scheme and got to this point. I don't want any talk that we ain't really married. We just shacking up over here. I didn't see you getting married. You ain't married. I think we got witnesses before God and man that I have made this commitment. And not only that, when you make a commitment in the presence of witnesses, it kind of makes it more in your mind that, hey, I got to keep this commitment. But see, if nobody sees it, then maybe if I get tired of this man, I can just kind of step away. They didn't know I was married to him anyway. Who said that I belong to him? And, or who says that I have to take responsibility for this Moabitess woman for the rest of my life? I've got witnesses here that I have made this commitment. So now, in order not to shame myself and God, I'm going to have to live up to this commitment.
That was a covenant then. And I think, you know, we live under a different covenant. We have a better covenant. Because as I said, if something had happened to all those 10 men at one time, then the kinsman could have come back and said, could have. You know, that didn't really happen. But now, and when we have a document that's signed, everybody could be off the scene. But when we have our document, then that's our thing. That although everybody, all the 10 or 20, wherever, or whomever, are gone, we still have a document that shows that this was a legal transaction.
It was a legal transaction.
Great stuff.
Therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it for thee. So he drew off his shoe. And Boaz said unto the elders and to all the people, ye are witnesses this day that I have bought all that it was Elimelech, and all that was Chilion and Mahlon of the land of Naomi. So we got witnesses today that this is my right, this is my land now, this is my responsibility now. And moreover, Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife. So I want to hear no talk here. Coming in with me, where did I come up with this Moabite woman? Praise God, this is my right. This was Mahlon's wife, my kinsman. And this is my right. To raise up the name of the dead among his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brother and from the gate of his place, ye are witnesses this day. Now, I think that it's important, and I really think that the lesson started, ended a verse too late. I think verse 11, the response of the witnesses is important to me as well. There, somebody read verse 11 in Ruth 4:11.
Now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requestest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman.
And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, we are witnesses. The Lord make the woman that is come unto thine house like Rachel and like Leah, which too did build the house of Israel, and do thou worthily in Ephrath, and be famous in Bethlehem.
In other words, the elders not only the elders, but everybody else that was around, pronounced the blessing upon him. He says, may these women be like Rachel and like Ruth. Now, what do we know about Rachel?
Rachel was favorite over Leah, and they all had children, and from that lineage.
From that lineage, the whole Jewish race was established. Rachel, and I think it says that Rachel's children weep sometimes when they're talking about Israel. It's considered Rachel's children. In other words, all of Israel was blessed or established because of Rachel. And they were actually prophesying here to an extent here. That every, you know, they no way that they could have known, you know, other than possibly God had put that in their mouth, that the whole earth is going to be blessed through the offspring of this woman, Ruth. So may you be like Rachel. Praise God. Now that's some blessing there. And you know, in Jewish, you know, they have many, 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 many children was a sign of blessings. As a matter of fact, not to have children was considered a curse. Praise God. So they're pronouncing blessings upon them, and they saying, look, your name be famous in all the earth. You stepped up as the next of kin, as kinsmen. And so we appreciate what you're doing, and we even gonna pronounce blessings upon you. Now that's the end of our lessons there, but there's some really, really, I really like the way the author, you know, some of the things that he brought out in the deal where it says practical point. It says God's work should always be done in a way that is proper and that is timely. And, you know, Ruth could have schemed, hallelujah, to get a wife. I mean, or Naomi could have schemed to get a wife for her, to make her daughter-in-law the wife of a Jewish man. You know, she could have, you know, schemed, she could have taken advantage, you know, of the fact that this man is drunk, you know, instead of laying down there at his feet, you know, and all. But she told her the proper way to go in and to do this. But you know what? I wonder, you know, we mentioned to the fact earlier that Ruth was not walking in faith, but I think Ruth had really kind of changed her course here because, first of all, Ruth knew the law. She knew that there was a kinsman before Boaz. You think maybe God may have been dealing with her, telling her what to do to get her daughter-in-law in that place? Because if she had been walking in the flesh, she may have said, wait, get out of Boaz's field and go over to this other kinsman's field. But that's not what God had purposed there. And you know, and the point that is really important to me that makes that out of that is, and the lesson that we can take with this is, you know how sometimes circumstances, and you as humans, we naturally tend to look at circumstances and we get out of faith. And the Bible says, whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Well, Ruth was out of faith at that time. And yes, she was walking in sin at that time. But the point to this is that even though you get out of faith, or you get off the course, that it's never too late to go back and get in faith. And when you get in faith, God honors your faith. And not only does he honor your faith, but he will direct your path to where even though it looks like you should go this direction in the natural mind, and there's no reason to go to the right, he can put that upon your heart that, look, I know this is what it looks like, but if you'll trust me and you'll go this way, everything will be okay. Everything will work out okay. I think that's what happened in this case. Naturally, she would have looked at that kinsman that was at the gate to do that. But because she had gotten back in faith and she realized that God was the one, it was his law, and that God was taking care of them and was leading them, she was able to hear from God and give her daughter-in-law instructions as to where to go to find all these blessings that it might be. She said, she wished that, shall I not find rest with you, that it might be well with you. Praise God. I think that that's an awesome lesson to take out of this. You know, old folks used to say, turn right and go straight. You know, you may sometimes veer off to the left and off of course and out of faith. But if you turn right, then the opposite direction, going straight, God can lead you straight to the blessings. Praise God. Honesty should be the rule of every Christian presentation. Boaz was an honest man, and so that's why he went and did it in a proper way. Look, I know that I've been promised blessings, and it looks like the blessings shouldn't come this way. And you know, sometimes, have you ever met children, saved folks that's kind of arrogant in it? You know, not humble in it. This is my right, and I'm going to do it. I remember when I first got saved, and praise God, and I guess I always wonder why I had to go through this. You had folks come up to you and tell you, the Lord told me you need to give this to me so you can be blessed. This is my right so you can be blessed. You know, God had told me, you know. And of course now they kind of look at him and say, well, you know, that's kind of funny because I don't think I heard God say that. And that's why it's important to stay on your knees and in prayer so you know the voice of God, because you get all kinds of things. And sometimes people, it wasn't really so that they had, I think they really believed, you know, that they would get right and that would do that and that would be blessed. But they're looking in the natural saying, okay, she looks like she got some money, so she can give it to me, you know. And, you know, Bible does say give and it shall be given unto you. But, you know, if I didn't hear the voice of God, I probably would have got rid of my blessing and all, and been wondering why, wait a minute, how come I'm not blessed? But I wasn't hearing the voice of God, praise God. But God can lead you, if you're humble, to that area there to where you can be blessed. And that was Ruth. She was a humble woman. We established that in the other lesson, and that he led her into the place to where not only did she get blessed, but when she got blessed, she blessed the rest of the world. A wise person listens carefully before speaking. You know, the kinsman, as I said, he could have said, hey, this is mine, I'm gone. And you know, it would have been, look like I, you know, in the natural, look like I'm adding to my will. It really surprised me. He says, I can't do this lest I mar my own inheritance. And I got to thinking, now, what could that mean? I mar my own inheritance. And there's a scripture that says, what man buyeth a field of going to war without first counting the cost? You know, he may have been thinking, well, you know what, if I take on this, you know, yes, it was, I will redeem it, you know. But then he thought, well, you know what, I better listen there. He's telling me some more information here. Yeah, I will have a lot more wealth and I'll have a lot more land, but I'm going to have a lot more responsibility. He may have been thinking, well, maybe I'm taking on so much that I can't do it all, and all of this will go bad, and my inheritance will be marred. Or he could have been thinking, well, look, I know that the firstborn here, that inheritance is not going to be mine. That child is not going to be coming from my inheritance. That's going to be, he's going to inherit what would have been Malon, what would have been Eliphaz. He might have been an old man. Wait, where's my seed coming from? I don't know. It doesn't say because he's unnamed. No. But he got to thinking, you know, if I take on this extra responsibility, you know, I just can't do that. Praise God. And sometimes that's the way we have to think. Sometimes things look really, really good when they're presented to you. But when it's not in God's will or God's timing, you know, those blessings can end up being a curse for us. Praise God. I remember I used to wonder, Lord, why won't you give this to me? Why can't I do this? Why can't I? Especially, I shared with you all when I got saved that how Daniel got the word, and I, you know, just clear understanding, and I was like, I might as well have been reading a foreign language. I didn't get nothing. You know, and I would cry before the Lord and say, Lord, why? Well, you know, I kind of understand now, because even though I was quiet, you know, I try to be kind of nice most of the time. But you know, I kind of had a reputation for being smart. You know, in school, I was always the smart one, and then that's when Daniel, you know, you're the smart one and all that. Well, I think I could have gotten puffed up in that, thinking, you know, that I am the smart one and go on off and God would, you know, I'm teaching all off course. Praise God. But God had to kind of hide the word to me until I got to that point where I could be humble and say, okay, Lord, that even though I understand your word, I understand also that it's not me, it's you. And it doesn't matter how I speak your word, I can quote the Bible from one page to the other. If you are not in here with me and it's not your anointing, there's nothing that can be done. And if I had gone on with the word and gone on and taught off all the things, I'd have caused other folks to go astray. And what does it say about the person that to leave the children? It's better that a milestone be put about it and you be drowned in the sea. It could be my own doom. Praise God. Even though the word was good, and it was good for me to have the word, God had to wait until I got to a point to where I knew how to handle the word before he gave it to me. I realize that now, but I didn't. I cried and I cried and I cried. And even at a point, I even thought, maybe I'm just not saved. Because not only was Donnell doing it, but I'm sitting here listening to all my brothers and sisters around me. And some of them came in the church after I did. And God is using them. I said, well, what's wrong with me that you can't use me, God? But I was quiet enough and wise enough to keep my mouth closed and just to keep looking. So y'all didn't know what I didn't know. Praise God. And not only that, but I didn't say anything or do anything that would have kept me from getting to the point that I had to be. Praise God. For point four is caring for others is seldom without a cost to oneself. The kinsman realized that it was going to be a cost. He said, this is going to mar my inheritance. Boaz also considered that there's going to be a cost to doing this. I'm taking on the responsibility here of caring for this woman, adding other mouths to my to my deal. I'm taking on a big responsibility here, and but it says that we should compare that to what Christ did. The Bible says that he that knew no sin became sin for us. Praise God. There was a cost in him doing what he did for us. A great cost. And just like the kinsman there, he could have said, hey, wait a minute. He could have said, you know, when he was in that garden, when he said, Father, take this cup away from me. He could have left off, nevertheless, let thy will be done. Praise God. He counted up the cost and he was willing to pay that cost. The kinsman, the first one, wasn't willing to pay that cost. Praise God. But he was willing to pay that cost. The Bible says that he became poor that we might become rich. Praise God. A wise person gathers witnesses to all important public decisions. And that's what I was saying there. You get witnesses to the important things that are in your life. We want witnesses to the fact that I'm dedicating my life to Christ. That's why we publicly have to confess Christ. That's why we are supposed to go before the church and before man and publicly pronounce that we are committed to be man and wife. Praise God. And any other important decision in our life, we should have witnesses to that fact. And a Christian should do his godly duty without reservation. Boaz did not have any reservations about taking on this responsibility at all. Colossians 3:23, I think it references to here. And somebody find it before I do.
And whatsoever you do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men.
Praise God. And so we are to do things heartily as unto the Lord. Without reservation, when you see the right thing to do, then we are to do it as unto the Lord and not as unto men, because our reward doesn't come from men, first of all. And second of all, because God loves a cheerful giver. Praise God. He loves a cheerful giver. When we give ourselves willingly and heartily and cheerfully, we're saying, Lord, I respect you. I respect your law. I respect everything that you told me to do. I'm willing to obey. And even if it is hard and with a cost, I'm willing to do it, and I'm doing it cheerfully. Praise God. Anybody have any comments?
Would Boaz have been out of order to not have taken care of Ruth? Maybe. He wasn't obligated, was he?
He wasn't obligated because there was a kinsman in his place. Actually, it was a kinsman who was obligated. He just gave the kinsman a way out.
But the kinsman, but if the kinsman had wanted to, he would have forfeited. He wasn't obligated. I mean, according to the law, he should have. Yes. But then the law also gave him a way out if he didn't want to.
Right.
But your question is, was he obligated?
In any sense of the word. I mean, she could have lived in the city forever. Had he not been attracted to her, was there why, or was that just the way God was taking care of
her? I think that's just the way God orders. And sometimes it lets us know that sometimes the way that we think it should be ordered is not God's way. Praise God.
But now, wasn't it also that Ruth was a handsome woman, a good-looking woman?
I'm sure
she was a lot younger than Boaz, and a young, beautiful woman. Be wanting to look at an older man.
As a matter of fact, that was in one of our previous lessons. He says, look, you've been kind to me and my own kinsman. You didn't go after wealth. You didn't go after riches. You didn't go after a younger man. You honored me. You realized there. You're kinder than even, some of the other people there. That was in, I think, chapter 2, if I'm not mistaken, of Ruth.
Self-conversation.
I mean, the thing about Boaz, I mean,